Hello students,
welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs for 17th of April 2021. So today you have the current affairs class, which is basically useful for your civil services examination preparation as well as other government competitive examinations. As you know that in the examination you require to answer the few questions related to current affairs. For that purpose, you must study the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. You can read any of these newspapers. Both of these newspapers are equally good. All right. And you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. So these video lectures, which are based on the current affairs, are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these lectures. All right. So let's begin with the lecture. All right. Okay. So first is basically the Ropax jetty project in Odisha. Okay. So a 110 crore Ropax jetty project, which is going to come up in Odisha. Okay. It is going to come up in the river Dhamra in the Odisha. So what is that? What is that Ropax jetty project? So first of all, you must understand the river Dhamra, where this project is going to come. Okay. So Dhamra is basically a joint stream in Odisha. Joint stream means where the two rivers basically join. So it's a joint stream in Odisha that is formed out of the confluence of the Brahmani river and Baitarani river. Okay. Now it is formed right to the south of town of the Chandavali. Okay, so it is basically a joint confluence, right? It is formed out of the confluence of this Brahmani and the Baitarani. Now it lies basically in the Bhadrak district of Odisha, and it ultimately emptied into the Bay of Bengal. Okay, to the north of its mouth we have this Dhamra port. Okay, and near the mouth is basically you have the famous Gahirmatha sanctuary. This Gahirmatha sanctuary is basically world famous for the nesting site for Olive Ridley sea turtles. All right. So the Ministry of Ports, Shipping and the Waterways, which is a nodal ministry for the development of the port related infrastructure, have accorded the administrative approval for the Ropax. The Ropax jetty means you have the roll on and roll off passenger jetty. Now, what is that roll on and roll off passenger jetty? As well as allied infrastructure, specifically in the Odisha. So it will be basically connecting the two places, that is in Keninali in Bhadrak district of Odisha with the Talachua in Kendrapara district of Odisha, right, under Sagarmala initiative. So it's a just and port-like development infrastructure project, which will have certain aspects of the development, like you have the Ropax jetty. The Ropax jetty means you have the roll-on, roll-off passenger jetty, as well as you have other associated infrastructure projects, right? So that will be basically connecting the two districts of Odisha under Sagarmala initiative. So what is this Ropax? So Ropax means the roll-on, roll-off passenger jetty. Okay. So you must understand this roll-off, roll-off passenger jetty is basically, they are nothing but ships, right? Are basically cargo ships. They are designed to carry the wheeled cargo, right? Such as cars, trucks, semi-trailer trucks, trailers, railroad cars, right? So they are basically those type of ships. They are designed to carry the wheeled cargo. We are mainly concerning about the wheeled cargo. That is what they are called Ro-Ro, Ro-Ro, Ro-Ro passenger jets, or Ro-Ro basically cargo jetty, right? That is also known as the roll-on, roll-off passenger jetty, because they are mainly used for the transportation of this wheeled cargo. Okay. And they are driven on and off of the ship on their own wheels using a platform vehicle, right? Such as self-propelled modular transporter, right? You can understand it is basically contrast to the lift on or lift off vessels, which are basically used with the help of cranes. So it is self-rolled, right? The vehicle are driven off by driven on and off of the ships, right, by using their own wheels. That is what it is called, roll on and roll off. By itself, they can move up, they can move down from the basically you know, from the cargo ship. But when you say the when you say basically the Lolo vessels, the Lolo vessels are basically opposite to this Roro vessels. Lolo ka matlab ho gaya simple lift on and lift off. That means you need basically the cranes for that purpose. Okay, now after understanding this, now let's understand what is this Sagarmala initiative under which this Ropax jetty is basically going to construct or going to manufacture. So this Sagarmala program is first of all is an initiative of Government of India. The main purpose of Sagarmala initiative is to enhance the performance of the country's logistics sector. As you know that the logistic cost involved in transportation of various, you know, are either cargo or passenger, they are very, very high, right? So this program basically emphasizes the unlocking, you know, the potential of these waterways. Through this, you know, the cargo will be ultimately sent, right? And simultaneously to minimize the infrastructure investment which are required to meet the target. So the Sagarmala project is seeking to develop the string of ports. You're getting my point? They are seeking to develop the string of port around India's coastline. The objective of this Sagarmala initiative is to promote the port-led development, right? The port-led infrastructure development along India's 7,500 kilometers long coastline. So this is under also the Sagarmala initiative, which is also the port-led development program where the all-weather Ropax jetty will be manufactured, or here the associated allied infrastructure will also be constructed. Okay. And in that process, the total outlay or the total capital cost for that project would be around 110 crore rupees, right? Which include the construction of Ropax jetty at Kaninali and Talachia that will be ultimately connected, right? And that will also have associated infrastructure such as the parking area development, navigational aids, as well as the dredging facilities and dredging infrastructure facilities in the water bodies, right? And obviously, this project, once it completed and once these two, Kaninali and Talachua, both these, you know, the towns are connected, that project will ultimately reduce the travel time from the travel time from 6 hours to just 1 hour. So you can understand there will be net saving of the 5 hours, right, with the help of these, you know, these port-led infrastructure. So instead of going by six, spending extra 5 hours, you can save those 5 hours and you can just connect these two places in just 1 hour. Okay, so this Kaninali, which is in basically Bhadrak district in Orissa, and Talachua is also in the Orissa, which is the Kendrapara district in Orissa, are basically located on the northern and the southern banks of River Dhamra, right? So that I have already explained you about River Dhamra. Okay, so here you can understand you have the Kaninali and you have Talachua, which are basically located to the northern and southern bank of River Dhamra. Okay, and they are basically located in the Bhadrak as well as in our Kendrapara district of Orissa, which are basically also located nearby in the Orissa state, right? And this Dhamra river basically emptied into the Bay of Bengal. All right. Then you have the Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana National Rural Livelihood Mission. So first of all, let's understand what is that Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana National Rural Livelihood Mission. First of all, let's understand this. So the DAYNRLM are basically, you know, is a new name to the Ajivika Mission. Previously, the Government of India implemented the Ajivika Mission. So it's a new name which have been given to the Ajivika Mission, that is the Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana National Rural Livelihood Mission. So what is that? Right, what is that? This renaming was done in November 2015, right? This Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana National Rural Livelihood Mission initiative is to move towards the demand driven strategy that will enable the state to formulate their own livelihood based poverty reduction plans. So ultimate purpose is to formulate, right, some sort of a, you know, the poverty reduction or poverty reduction action plans, right? That is the core of this mission. So that is what is Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana, how to work, right? So here, what is the news is that the gender samvad event. Samvad means you will have the debating type of, you know, an event. So that will be on the gender equality and gender empowerment. So that is called gender samvad event, right? So here, gender samvad event, which is jointly organized by, right, the Dindyal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission, as well as the initiative for what works to advance women and the girls in the economy. That is an NGO, that is in short form for IWWAGE, right? Both of these, you know, initiatives are basically put forwarding for this Gender Samvad event. The ultimate aim of this Gender Samvad event to create a common platform, right, where the people can come and share, right, their efforts, which was organized by the Ministry of Rural Development. All right. So the attempt ultimately for this Gender Samvad event to generate the greater awareness on the gender related interventions, the gender sensitivities, right, under Dindyal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission across the country. And also the focusing on the best practices across the country, and also hearing the voices from the states, from the fields, from the, you know, from the weaker sections of the society. Okay. So here the organization called the Initiative for What Works to Advance Women and Girls in the Economy is nothing but an NGO. First of all, it is an NGO which is located in India. It involved in gender and human rights and social initiative regarding to the women, right? So this initiative for what works to advance women and the girls in the economy, it is an NGO which aims to support, right, some sort of a, you know, solutions and the policies through the multi-stakeholder platform that is basically using some sort of a evidence-based and research-based, right, some sort of a arguments to ensure the economic empowerment of women in our country. All right. So here you must understand, around 60 million women have already been mobilized under the Dindyal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission. So it is one of the largest, India's largest livelihood mission program for the poverty alleviation reduction plans, right? And this National Rural Livelihood Mission have had the great promises specifically for the socio-economic empowerment of the women. Why? Because it has set up, or it has enabled to set up, the self-help groups, which is basically, you know, a group of the women specifically, which are basically pooling their resources for the development of their own well-being, right? As well as it is also enabling on organizing the federations of the rural poor that will ultimately help in the, you know, the socio-economic empowerment of the women, right? And in 2016, the Dindyal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission, also has laid down the gender operational strategy, right? The ultimate purpose of this gender operational strategy to mainstream gender issues, because now these gender issues are not mainstream in the budget or in the other, you know, developmental avenues. So to mainstream the gender issues, right, within a federal architecture, and the focusing on, you know, the some sort of a capacity building, training, all sort of associated staffs, cadres, institutions, so that they can become more sensitive towards the gender needs, towards the, you know, the unique women needs, towards the unique girls needs, right? And they can basically help in the women's socioeconomic empowerment in our country. So ultimately to resolve all sort of the gender issues from our country in a positive way. All right. So this is a purpose that is basically for that purpose, this Samvad is basically organized. Now, obviously this is coupled with the establishment of institutional platform. So obviously you need the institutional development, right? You need that institution for that. With the help of that, you must focus on the social action committees and the gender resource centers, which will ultimately help, right, the women and the girls specifically for their socioeconomic development at the field level, right? So that the women can directly approach them for their grievances, if they have any sort of grievances, and they can also have the entitlement of their rights, the rights which have been given by the constitution, right? So all such things, all such institution development is also well important for ultimate gender empowerment as well as for socio-economic development of the women in our country. Okay, so you can see here the self-help group, which is made up of the women. Okay, next, you have Duro Kia series. Now you must understand, it is a, first of all, it is a product, it is a world first affordable and long lasting hygiene product. which is known as the Durokia series. Now, this product is first of all developed by the Indian Institute of Technology, Hyderabad researchers. So IIT Hyderabad have formulated world first affordable and long lasting hygiene product in our country that is known as the Durokia series. So Union Minister of Education have launched this Durokia series in the country. So let's understand first a brief about IIT Hyderabad. So IIT Hyderabad is also known as Indian Institute of Technology Hyderabad. It's a public technical and the research institution, right, which is located in the Sangareddy district of Telangana, which is newly carved out from Andhra Pradesh, right? The Indian Institute of Hyderabad is founded in 2008 among with 8 young Indian Institute of Technology, which have also set up in the same year, right? So they have, or IIT Hyderabad researchers have developed this, the unique product, which is known as the Durokia, which is a long lasting technology, right? Obviously that will basically help in the combating of the COVID-19 virus spreading. So here you must understand this Durokia series have the antimicrobial technology. This antimicrobial technology, right, you can just afford, you can just affordable, it's also, it can, you can purchase it just by 189 rupees, and it kills around 99.99% germs instantly, just in 60 seconds. So 99.99% germs is instantly killed with the help of this antimicrobial technology, and it will also leaves behind long lasting protection also, right? And it will also have the nanoscale coating, right, that will be effective up to 35 days till next wash. You are getting my point? So it will give you the long lasting, you know, protective coating also that will be lasting up to 35 days. So it is highly, you know, affordable, it is long lasting, you know, the product. And this unique property of this Durokia range is basically to ensure the instant killing of all viruses within the 60 second, and that will definitely give you the prolonged protection for up to 35 days, and that will help in, you know, the dealing with the current pandemic situation in our country. So this revolutionary antimicrobial property of the Durokia products is basically is one of the innovation, right, which have done by the India's premier institution called IIT Hyderabad, right? And it has already been tested and certified by the Indian government accredited labs, right? And it has already been field tested at IIT Hyderabad campus. All right, so next you have the Kakarala Subbarao. The Kakarala Subbarao is basically a renowned radiologist in our country, right? The Vice President of India expressed his condolence to the demise of the renowned radiologist, Dr. Kakarala Subbarao. Dr. Kakarala Subbarao was basically a renowned radiologist who was born in 1925 and who has recently died in 2021, right? He was also the first director of Nizam Institute of Medical Sciences, Hyderabad, and he has greatly contributed to the field of medicine, specifically in the radiology, right? And he has already conferred for his contribution in the field of medicine the Padam Shri in 2000, right? And he is also the founder president of Telugu Association of the North America. He is basically Dr. Subbarao, who is basically renowned radiologist. Next, you have National Green Tribunal. Now let's understand first, what is this National Green Tribunal? So the parliament has passed the National Green Tribunal Act 2010, that is also known as NGT Act 2010. Under NGT Act 2010, right, which is passed by the parliament, right, the National Green Tribunal was basically set up. The ultimate purpose of setting up of this special tribunal to handle the expeditious disposal of the cases which are related to the environmental issues. So this tribunal will basically deal the cases expeditiously with respect to those cases which are related to the environmental issue. Okay. So the National Green Tribunal have constituted the 8-member National Task Force. This 8-member National Task Force is basically have constituted by the National Green Tribunal. The ultimate purpose of this setting up of this National Task Force is to combat air pollution and to monitor the remedial steps ultimately to improve the air quality. So this national task force will comprise of the senior officials, obviously from the ministry, that is the Ministry of Environment and the Forest and Climate Change, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, the Ministry of Petroleum, the Ministry of Transport, the Ministry of Power, the Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Health, and Central Pollution Control Board. So this national task force will have the senior officials from the different ministries. Okay. And the national task force will also monitor the enforcement, right, related to the air quality standards and regulations which have been implemented. And it will also monitor beyond the non-attainment cities, right, specifically in their other air identified or air polluted areas where the quality of the air is very poor or poor, right? So they will also monitor such type of enforcement in those areas also. And in the city level or at the state level, the chief secretaries of the states, right, on also with the union territories, they will continue to monitor the progress of the plans which have been implemented by the respective state government or respective union territories with respect to combating this air pollution at the state level. And at the state level, with the assistance of these monitoring cells which have been set up in their offices, right, as well as with the help of this air quality monitoring committees that have also been set up for the monitoring of the air quality parameters in those respective states and the union territories. All right. So here you can see the National Green Tribunal, which is basically, a tribunal which have been set up under NGT Act 2010. Okay. Next, the overseas citizens of India. So first of all, let's understand what is this overseas citizenship of India. So you can understand that the overseas citizenship of India or OCIE is a form of permanent residency, right? Is a form of permanent residency based on certain qualifications, right? So which will be available to the people of Indian origin, to the people of Indian origin and their spouses, right? This OCI will allow them to live and work in India indefinitely. You're getting my point. Despite of this name, which is also known as Overseas Citizenship of India, right? It is not a citizenship. It is not a citizenship because that does not grant to those people who were eligible to work in India indefinitely. This OCI does not grant to those people the right to vote in the Indian elections, as well as they cannot hold the public offices in our country. So it is definitely a different from the citizenship, but it is certain rights which have been granted based on the eligibility of the persons. So here the rules which have been made by the Home Ministry, right, which says that the person who has, at the time of, the new passport which is issued, every time the fresh OCI card is needed. Right. So every time, whenever the new passport is issued to the person, the fresh OCI card is also, the person has to register for the fresh OCI card. That means for every new passport, the person has to acquire the fresh OCI card. Now, the Ministry of Home Affairs have done away with this requirement. That means whenever you have to have the new passport or whenever you want to have the new passport, you don't have to have the registration for the fresh OCI card every time. So that procedural requirement has been done away with as per the Ministry of Home Affairs statement. So the Ministry of Home Affairs says that the OCI card is required to be reissued every time, right? That is, the new passport is issued up to 20 years of the age, right? That means once the person is up to 20 years of the age, right, you have to have the OCI card that is required to be reissued every time, whenever the new passport is issued. And once the person is completing the age of 50, right, that is something to detect the face of an applicant, right? So in order to facilitate this OCI card holders, right, now it has decided that this whole procedure to be dispensed with or whole procedure to be done away with. Okay. Now what is required is under the new norms, right? You just need a registration for the OCI card holder prior to the age of 20 years, right? That means once you have to have registration for the OCI card holder prior to the age of 20 years. Okay. That is only once. And once you complete your 20 years of the age, you have to have once for you, for your also for your, you know, facial capture. That is, you after attaining your adulthood, you have to have again for the new passport, and for that purpose you have to capture your own facial features, and that only that point, that time also you have to attain that type of card. Okay, so if the person has obtained a registration as an OCI card holder after attaining the age of 20 years, right, then he does not require to again reissue of this OCI card again if the person is applying for the new passport, right? He does not require for that the new registration for the OCI card holder as per the new norms which have been made by the Ministry of Home Affairs. Okay, let's understand the wholesale price for the wholesale price index. So first of all, what is this wholesale price index? The wholesale price index is an index definitely that measures and tracks the changes in the prices of the good, right, in the stages just well before the retail level. You are getting my point? So they will measure and tracks down the changes in the price of the goods in the stages just well before, you know, the retail level. Okay, so the news says that the wholesale level inflation, which is measured by the WPI or wholesale price index, has shot up 7.39% in the March. That is on the year-on-year basis. So wholesale price inflation have shot up, have increased to 7.39%. Now let's understand what is the reason for this surge. So the reason is, first of all, you know, since October 2012, right, there was, you know, the high rises of the prices of the crude oil. The crude oil prices jump up, and there is also the rise in the prices of the food items such as pulses and the fruits, which has led to the rising up of this wholesale level inflation in our country. Okay, and the surge is also, you know, aided by the low base, that is into the corresponding to the month of 2020. Okay, now what is this WPI constituent? So first of all, you must understand, while you consider or while you calculate this consumer price index based retail inflation, right, which is basically most widely used tool, right, which is basically used at the consumer level when the consumer buy the goods. But when you say the wholesale price index, this wholesale price index basically tracks the prices at the wholesale level, right, at the mandi gate, at the mandi level, not at basically at the consumer level or at the retail level. So here you can say that between wholesale price and the retail price, there is definitely a difference, right? So the wholesale price basically tracks down the basic prices, that is, that does not involve any sort of a transportation cost, taxes, or a retail margin. But the retail prices definitely involve all such transportation costs, taxes, and the retail margin also, right? And moreover, the wholesale price index also pertains to only goods. The wholesale price index does not cover services, right? But again, the retail prices, you have to cover both of these things, for the goods as well as for your services also. So these are basically some of the basic difference between WPI and your CPI. Okay, now if you say that the wholesale price index basically captures the average movement of the wholesale prices of the goods, right, not the services, first of all, that is primarily used as a GDP deflator, right? You have read this thing in your economy, right, in the Indian economy, the concept, the GDP deflator is basically shown with the ratio of the exact value of goods, right, that is produced in the economy in a particular year at the current prices, right? Current prices means the today's prices, right, divided by or to the prices that is prevailed during the base year, that is basically used as a reference year or as a base year. Okay, now let's understand brief about the wholesale price index. The wholesale price index is basically published by the economic advisor. Okay, the economic advisor, thus economic advisor in the Ministry of Commerce and the Industry. Okay, the wholesale price index basically focuses on the prices of the goods that is being traded between corporations. Now understand, the wholesale price index focuses on the goods, focuses on the prices of the goods that has been traded between the corporations rather than the goods which have been brought by the consumers. You are getting the point? So which is basically measured with the help of your WPI. Now This wholesale price index is basically index that is measures and tracks the changes in the prices of the goods, definitely just well before the retail label. So that means it refers to the goods that are sold in the bulk, right? And that is the traded between the entities or the businesses or different business persons. It does not traded between the consumers. If it is traded between the consumers, it will be considered as a consumer price index. All right. Next, the whitest paint. Now the engineers from the Purdue University, which is the leading university in the USA, have created the whitest paint yet. Whitest, right? So they have claimed that they have made this whitest paint, which is basically once been applied on the surface of your walls or on your roof, that will allow the complete, the cooling down of the building, that it does not require, right? Or it reduces the need of air conditioning, because such type of whitest paint will definitely reflect the maximum amount of the heat or maximum amount of sun rays, which is basically coming from the sun. So the whitest surface or the light surface basically reflect the maximum amount of, this heat. So the Purdue University engineers have manufactured this whitest paint. So let's understand about the Purdue University. The Purdue University is basically public land grant based research university in Western Lafayette, Indiana. Indiana is a state in the USA, and it is a flagship campus of the Purdue University system. This Purdue University was set up, or it was founded in 1869 after a businessman known as John Purdue donated the land and the money to establish this college. And this college is named after Mr. John Purdue, who have donated the land and money to establish this college for science, technology, and agriculture. So it is the premier, the technological university in the USA, which is set up in Indiana. Okay, so team of the researchers of the Purdue University have created an ultra white paint in October that is beyond the what is available in the white paint in our market. Okay, now this older formulation, which are made up of the calcium carbonate, right? Whatever you have, the white paint is basically consisting of the calcium carbonate. But now this whitest paint will have the barium sulfate. Barium sulfate means BaSO4, right? This barium sulfate would make it the more white, will make it ultimately more white. So what is this barium sulfate, which will make this paint as a whitest paint? So barium sulfate is basically an inorganic compound, right? With a chemical formula of, first of all, BaSO4, okay? It is a white crystalline solid. It is a white crystalline solid, which is also odorless and insoluble in the water. It is a chemical property which is odorless and insoluble in the water, and it basically occurs in the mineral. That mineral is known as barite, right? And which is a main commercial source for the obtaining of this barium, right? And from this minerals barite, this barium sulfate ultimately formed. Okay, so here the new paint is whiter and the keep surface areas, right, cooler than the formulation which was basically previously used. So here the new paint can be used to cover the roof area up to 1000 square feet, and it will be able to cool the power, or it will be able to get the cooling power up to 10 kilowatts. So you can understand, if you paint this whitest paint on the area of 1000 square feet, you will get the cooling power up to 10 kilowatt of energy. So that means that amount of energy you are ultimately going to save with the help of this whitest paint. So typical commercial paint, white paint, which is available in our market, that is consisting of calcium carbonate or CaCO3, right? That ultimately makes the building rather warmer, right, than cooler. So, which is primarily available in the market. So they can reject only 80 to 90% of the sunlight. But now this paint is able to reject maximum amount of the sunlight, which is basically coming to the surface of the building, right? That makes the building much cooler than their surroundings. All right. So the team has further claimed that this paint may be the closest equivalent to the blackest black paint that is also known as Venta Black. This Venta Black would absorb 99.99% of visible light. So this whitest paint will definitely going to reflect 99.99% of the visible light. So obviously it is just an against to the Venta Black. Okay. So here you can understand the whitest white paint. So you can see here how the glow of this whitest white paint would be look like. And this is basically consisting of mainly the barium sulfate, which is a chemical compound. And it is mainly consisting of the calcium carbonate. Okay. Next, you have the Doge coin. Now, what is this Doge coin? So first of all, the Doge coin is also a virtual currency. A virtual currency just like a Bitcoin or just like a Ethereum, right? This third type of currency or third type of, the digital currency, which is known as Doge coin. It is also a cryptocurrency. It started in 2013, right? Has just become, in the news. So first of all, what is this virtual currency? So virtual currency is a type of unregulated digital currency, first of all, right? Now it is not controlled generally. It is not controlled. It is not issued by any central bank generally. Okay. The example you can take of virtual currency is Bitcoin, the first virtual currency, right? This is basically operating on the blockchain technology, right? So Bitcoin is going to disrupt the currency market in the world. And what is this Ethereum? The Ethereum again is a decentralized open source, the blockchain technology with a smart contract functionality, right? So Ether is basically a native cryptocurrency of the platform, right? And it is the second largest cryptocurrency, right, which is used right in the market by the market capitalization after Bitcoin. Okay. And Ethereum is the most actively used blockchain after Bitcoin. Okay. So what is this Doge coin? See, this Doge coin is basically based on the Doge, which is a meme, which was started as a fun alternative to the Bitcoin. Okay. So Doge coin basically value have risen phenomenally this week. That is why it is in news. Now it has valued at $34 billion. That is a huge. And the market token, which is created in 2013 as the Doge coin, right, which have created by the software engineers called the Willy Marcus and Jackson Palmer, which have created this fun alternative to the Bitcoin. Now it has started as the satire on the numerous fraud cryptocurrency coin. Now this has spring up in the time. Okay, so there is some, the special added features with this Doge coin is that the Bitcoin whose maximum possible number is fixed at, that is 21 million. That is a fixed number that is associated with the Bitcoin, right? And that too, it is estimated to be reached by 2014, 21 million. But Doge coin has no such upper limit. And it has already been valued more than 100 billion in the existence. So you can understand. It will be more, uses than your Bitcoin in the world. Okay. Next, you have the Regulations Review Authority 2.0. Bank of India has announced the setting up of this Regulations Review Authority. So this Regulations Review Authority will be set up within RBI. Within RBI, the main purpose of Regulations Review Authority is to review its regulations internally, right? So whatever the RBI's regulations are there, right, that Regulations Review Committee would review them, and that will definitely review in the consultation with other stakeholders. So the RBI or the RBI basically have announced the setting up of this review, Regulations Review Authority. The Deputy Governor of RBI, Mr. Raj Shekhara Rao, have been appointed as a head of the review or Regulations Review Authority 2.0, which is going to be set up for 1 year from May 1st, 2021 to the 1 year. And now you must understand the Mr. Raj Shekhara Rao would have the 1 year tenure in that, committee or in that authority, and unless it is being extended, right? So the normal tenure for this authority would be 1 year. So this RRA 2.0, what is 2.0? That type of regulation review authority was previously also set up in 1999. Okay, now it is the second such authority which is set up by the Reserve Bank of India. Now, this regulations review authority would focus on the streamlining of the regulatory instructions, reductions, the compliance burden of the regulated entities. How it will do that? By simplifying the procedures, by reduction, by reducing, you know, some sort of a reporting requirement wherever possible, with the help of consultation with stakeholders. So first of all, one such regulations review authority was set up in a similar manner, right, which was conducted in 1999 to 2000, right, and is the second such regulations review authority which is set up from 1st May 2021, right, and the Central Bank already set up this regulations review authority for the period of 1 year, from 1st April 1999 to up to year 2000, right. Ultimate purpose to review the regulations, circulars, reporting systems based on the feedback from publics, banks and financial institutions, as well as with the consultation with other stakeholders in our country. All right. And whatever the recommendations which have been brought with the help of this regulations review authority would definitely enable the Reserve Bank of India to streamline and increasing the effectiveness of several procedures. Okay. And that will simplify the regulatory prescriptions, that will ultimately pave the way for the issuance of master circulars, and that will reduce the reporting burden on the regulated agencies, regulated entities, and that will be also, you know, ease various such regulations which are brought down by the Reserve Bank of India in our country. All right, so that's all for today. Thank you very much for today. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.